Okay, I guess we'll start. Welcome to the School of Architecture, the third of our five-part evening lecture series. Before beginning tonight's event, I just want to remind you once again of the last two lectures. A week from tonight is Sharon Johnston and Mark Lee from Los Angeles, and then in 2 weeks, Italian architect Renato Rizzi. Is that annoying? It's just me. Also, tonight you might realize that Bill Harris has come back to give part two of the lecture that he promised us last week already, so we have a double event. It's nice to have the continuing joining of the two schools. Also, as a public service announcement, I need to make... Where's Julia? Okay. My public service announcement is for Julia DeCastri. We are extending the poster competition, the lecture poster competition that she is organizing. The only problem is I don't know until when we are extending it without Julia here. So let's just say Friday. Who's due today, let's say Friday. I can make assignments just as easily. The idea of the competition, obviously, is as we celebrate our 50-year history, to also look forward, in some sense, to the next 50 years, so that the posters that you will do will enter a future archive beyond the posters that are already up on the ribbon documenting moments from the last 50 years. So you get to do both what you think the visual identity of the school is, but also whatever the pressing issue of that future moment is and who the personalities in that future moment will be. What's that?
No pressure.
No pressure, no. That's why we only have one in so far, I think. So I'm encouraging you to do it. Please do it. Otherwise, Amir and I will have very short work of naming the winner. So, finally, we want to wish everyone a happy Halloween. Thank you all for dressing like an architectural audience. Great job. It's spot on. You never know. It's realer than real. I've dressed as an architectural director tonight. In honor of Halloween and our 50-year anniversary, and particularly tonight's special lecture, we also ask that you join us for a reception upstairs after the lecture. I think we only have them and the catering from 6:30 to 7:45, so hopefully we will take our lecture discussion up there at some point after 6:30, but we'll see when that happens, or else we'll have to bring drinks down here from there, like the AA. Although we don't try to theme things, it's hard to imagine a better figure to be part of our gold anniversary lecture series than Elia Zenghelis, as Elia has personally been teaching for longer than the history of this school, and indeed longer than the history of this campus, having started his teaching career at the Architectural Association in 1963, just a couple of years after having graduated from the AA himself. It's perhaps not inaccurate to say that despite all of the significant work and projects Elia has done as a designer and thinker in architecture, all the historic collaborations and experiences he's been a central participant in, it is his continual commitment to teaching that is most marked, possibly because schools, when they are interesting at least, are the most receptive context for Elia's particular approach that intensifies both the polemical and the pleasurable aspects of architecture. Officially recognized in 2000 when he received the Annie Spink Award for Excellence in Education from the Royal Institute of British Architects, Elia's unmatched commitment to architecture through his teaching has been unofficially confirmed by the scores of designers and thinkers he has taught, inspired, and later collaborated with. Elia is a one-person nomadic school, and the contemporary landscape of architecture in this discussion today is simply unimaginable without his personal alumni network, for which he remains the modestly quiet and intellectually feverish center point. While at the AA, Elia introduced a series of history lectures as part of his commitment to the relationship between architecture and politics, particularly during periods of revolutionary transformation. He was the chair of the search committee that brought Alvin Boyarsky from this college at UIC to the AA, even though he wasn't Elia's first choice, but Elia came to think it was the best choice. And was Rem Koolhaas' unit tutor when Koolhaas undertook his now famous study on the Berlin Wall. In 1972, Elliot and Koolhaas collaborated on a competition sponsored by Casabella that would become their project Exodus for the Voluntary Prisoners of Architecture. And then on New Year's Eve 1975, along with Madelon Vriesendorp and Zoe Zenghelis, They co-founded the Office for Metropolitan Architecture, where Elia remained a partner until 1987. Elia undertook, both in the mid-70s while teaching at Columbia and also while living in New York, Elia undertook a series of projects that would graft a collective project of architecture to a luxury typology, such as the famous Hotel Sphinx, projects that would come to illustrate the fictional conclusion of Koolhaas' delirious New York. The early OMA projects that Elia led or co-authored include the Dutch Parliament Extension, the apartments at Checkpoint Charlie in Berlin, and the still highly influential seminal project for Parc de la Villette in 1982. After leaving the AA in 1985, and in addition to teaching at Columbia and Princeton, Elia assumed James Sterling's chair as Baukunst professor at the Kunst Academy in Dusseldorf from 1989 to 2002, taught at the Berlin Institute for nearly 20 years, from 1992 to 2010, and has most recently served as a Davenport professor at Yale. As a relentless voice, both for architecture as a generator of ideas and in favor of the project of architecture in its largest sense, often indeed the paper project of architecture, I like to think of Elia as a kind of godfather and patron saint of this school. He is still one of the clearest voices against the dangers of the predominant political economic context of neoliberalism in architecture. As he said in one recent interview, everything is smooth now. We no longer have conflict, and the conditions of conflict are, I think, very, very useful. A tradition to try to live up to with conflict in our school. Productive ideological conflict, I hope, most of the time. In another essay of Elia's on quotation that was just published in Perspective, Elia wrote that, like a book, a work of architecture must incorporate its own inheritance distilled within its projected newness. In other words, it's architecture's commitment simultaneously to the archaic and the future that might allow it to escape the debilitating demands of the present, an increasingly business-as-usual present that acts to foreclose both of the continuing architectural values Elia has left us, culture polemics and unexpected pleasures. Please join me in welcoming Elia to UIC, which I hope he accepts as one of the institutional offspring of the School of Zenghelis.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you for your kind words. And this is you're making this into a very tall order. I don't know how I can respond. But I'm going to try my best to go with the plan that I had prepared in mind, which is basically, I thought that this is an opportunity, since this is the first time I come to Chicago. I've been to Chicago the first time I lecture here. For a long time I've been wanting to kind of represent earlier projects, and in particular the Exodus project. And I've been wanting to represent it with a kind of restructured illustrations. So I thought that I would that my lecture would consist of two poles, which is the first thing that I've ever done that I kind of acquired recognition, and the most latest project that I've done, which I completed a year ago. And I thought that between these two poles I could show some examples of the intervening period, but I think there will be no time for that, and I'll just concentrate on the first two that I said, which actually the first one has a text and it's in my jacket, which is here. The idea is, of course, the title of the lecture, that images are a text in themselves. Oh, yes. But the Exodus project has a kind of this double text, which is the text of the image and the written text, and they kind of go together almost like a duet. Each proposing their own text. We need, I think, if the light is strong enough? I don't know, could we lower the light a bit? Or do you think it's the image is okay as it is? It's okay as it is. I may need a bit of illumination here, since we're reading. So, as Bob said, the Exodus project was in response to a very vaguely termed competition that the magazine Casabella issued in 1972, and the title of it was "The City as Significant Environment." There was nothing else said except for this very vague term. So the project was, if you like, a response to this vague title, and it kind of tended to deal with the with kind of more general issues about architecture in the city, and about the importance that we felt that it is architecture really that makes the city, something that we believed then and I still believe today. And this first image is the cover of Casabella, in which one of the illustrations of the project was one of the images done for the project were on the front, on the cover of that particular issue. So I begin with the project as the text as it was given then. Sorry. The project we kind of re-illustrate the accompanying illustrations having been reworked. Once a city was divided in two parts. One part became the good half, the other part the bad part of the city. The inhabitants of the bad part began to flock to the good part of the divided city, rapidly swelling into an urban exodus. If this situation had been allowed to continue forever, the population of the good half would have doubled. While the bad half would have turned into a ghost town. After all attempts to interrupt this undesirable migration had failed, the authorities of the bad part made desperate and savage use of architecture. They built a wall around the good part of the city, making it completely inaccessible to their subjects. The wall was a masterpiece. Originally no more than some pathetic strings of barbed wire, abruptly dropped on the imaginary line of the border, its psychological and symbolic effects were infinitely more powerful than its physical appearance. The good half now glimpsed over the forbidden distance or forbidden obstacle from an agonizing distance became even more irresistible. Those trapped, left behind the gloomy bad half, became obsessed with vain plans for escape. Hopelessness reigned supreme on the wrong side of the war. And as so often in this history of mankind, architecture was the guilty instrument of despair. It is possible to imagine a mirror image of this terrifying architecture, a force as intense and devastating, but used instead in the service of positive intentions. division, isolation, inequality, aggression, destruction, all the negative aspects of the war could be ingredients of a new phenomenon, architectural warfare against existing conditions, in this case, London. It would be an immodest architecture committed to desirable alternatives. I'm sorry, but I have here a little bit of confusion in that the inhabitants of this architecture would become its voluntary prisoners, ecstatic in the freedom of their architectural confines. And contrary to modern architecture and its afterbirths, this new architecture is neither authoritarian nor hysterical. It is the hedonistic science of designing collective facilities that fully accommodate individual desires. From the outside, this architecture is a sequence of serene monuments. The life inside produces a continuous state of ornamental frenzy and a decorative delirium, an overdose of symbols. This will be an architecture that generates its own successors. The study that we propose describes the steps that will have to be taken to establish an architectural oasis in the behavioral sink of London. Suddenly, a strip of intense metropolitan desirability runs through the center of London. Two walls enclose and protect this zone to retain its integrity and to prevent any contamination of its surface by the cancerous organism that threatens to engulf it. Soon the first inmates beg for admission. Their number rapidly swells into an unstoppable flow. We witness the exodus of London. London, as we know it, will become a pack of ruins. After crossing the wall, exhausted fugitives are received by attentive wardens in a lobby between the reception area and the wall. The consoling atmosphere of this waiting room is an architectural sigh of relief, the first step in the indoctrination program of the other side of the wall is being realized. The newcomers enter the reception area. On arrival, a spectacular welcome is given to all. The activities inside the reception area require minimal training for new arrivals, which is only accomplished by overwhelming previously undernourished senses. The reception area is permanently crowded by amateurs who exercise an inspired state of political inventiveness echoed by the architecture. The senses are overwhelmed. The sole concern of the participants are the present and future of the strip, in which, and in the proposal, contradictory programs are being proposed and fused without compromise. The central area. The roof of the reception area is a high altitude plateau from which both the decay of the old town and the physical splendor of the strip can be experienced. From here, a gigantic escalator descends into a preserved fragment of the old London. These ancient buildings provide temporary accommodation for recent arrivals during their training period. The area is an environmental sluice. The ceremonial square. The west side of the roof is completely empty, except for the tower of the jamming station, which will protect the inhabitants of the strip from electronic exposure to the rest of the world. This black square will accommodate a mixture of physical and mental exercises, a conceptual Olympics. The tip of the strip is the front line of the architectural warfare waged on the old London. Here, the merciless progress of the strip performs a daily miracle. The corrective rage of the architecture is at its most intense in a continuous confrontation with the old city. Existing structures are destroyed by the new architecture. A model of the strip, continuously modified through incoming information from the reception area, conveys strategies, plans, and instructions. Life in the building barracks of the tip of the street can be hard, but the ongoing creation of this object leaves the builders exhausted with satisfaction. The Square of the Arts. The Square of the Arts is devoted to the accelerated creation, evolution, and exhibition of objects. The Square of the Arts is the strip's industrial zone. There are three major buildings on the square. One is old and has been there for a long time. The other two were built by the voluntary prisoners. Of these two, the first bulges from the surface, and the second is carved out of the square and is the interior of the first. These buildings are instruments of indoctrination, exposing memory by allowing its vacuums to be filled with the onlooker's emotions. The visitors, driven by an irresistible power, begin a journey down the escalators into an exploration of the most mysterious corners of history. At the lowest gallery, they discover a bottomless interior. New galleries are under construction, filling as completed with unfamiliar works that emerge in a continuous flow from a tunnel that is seemingly connected to the old museum. Returning to the surface, the traces of the course, of this course, are retained on the retina and transferred to certain parts of the brain. This hallucinatory journey intensifies the suspense of arriving visitors who wait outside the gates, forming endless lines of anxious anticipation. The baths. The functions of the baths is to create and recycle private and public fantasies, to invent, test, and possibly introduce new forms of behavior. The building is a social condenser. It brings hidden motivations, desires, and impulses to the surface to be refined for recognition, provocation, and development. The ground floor is an area of public action and display, a continuous parade of personalities and bodies, a stage for a cyclical dialectic between exhibitionism and spectatorship. It is an area for the observation of possible seduction of partners who will be invited to participate actively in private fantasies and the pursuit of desires. The two long walls of the building consist of an infinite number of cells of various sizes to which individuals, groups, or couples can retire. These cells are equipped to facilitate the realization of fantasies and social inventions. They invite all forms of interaction and exchange. The public area private cell becomes a sequence for a creative chain reaction. Finally, in the arena they perform, the freshness and suggestiveness. For some reason, these drawings have kind of been fading in the last couple of days, but they have a good projector, so they still are okay. Overcharged by this spectacle, the voluntary prisoners descend to the ground floor looking for those willing and able to work out new elaborations. The Institute of Biological Transactions. The Institute sustains the voluntary prisoners through biological emergencies and physical and mental crises. It also demonstrates the harmless nature of mortality. It is divided into four parts by a cruciform building. The first part, the hospital, contains a complete arsenal of modern healing, but is devoted to a radical de-escalation of the medical process, to the abolition of the compulsive rage to heal. No forced heartbeats here, no chemical inventions, no sadistic extensions of life. This new strategy lowers the average life expectancy and relieves senility, physical decay, and exhaustion. In fact, patients here will be healthy. The hospital is a sequence of pavilions, each devoted to a particular disease. They are connected by a medical boulevard, a slow-moving belt that displays the sick in a continuous procession. With a group of dancing nurses in glitzy uniforms, medical equipment disguised as totem poles, and rich perfumes that suppress the familiar stench of healing, in an almost festive atmosphere of operatic melodies. Doctors select their patients from this belt, invite them to their individual pavilions, test their vitality, and almost playfully administer their medical knowledge. If they fail, the patient is returned to the conveyor. Perhaps another doctor tries the patient, but it soon becomes evident that if these doctors will not achieve a result, the belt as it continuously moves, leaves beyond the pavilions, through the cruciform building, and straight into the cemetery. The mood here is continuously festive. The same smell, the same ethereal dance made still more human. By the contrast between the ruthlessly formal layout of the plots and the unnaturalness of the dark green shrubbery. In the three palaces of birth, there is a statistical balance between births and deaths. The physical proximity of these suggests a causal relationship between the two, a gentle relay. The lowering of the average life expectancy creates an ambitious urgency. The three palaces of birth will also care for babies, turn them into small adults who can participate in the stream. In the fourth part, mental patients will be on display, as in former days, as part of a well-produced exhibition of their delusions, sustained by the most advanced technical equipment. An infinite number of Napoleons, Florence, Nightingales, Einsteins, Jesus Christ, and Joans of Arc, all in their custom-made uniform. Bureaucracy, as so often criticized for its moral blindness, guarantees a new kind of immortality. This statistical treasure produces not only instant recounts of the dead, but also premature biologies of the living, instruments for plotting the course and planning the future. The plan, the park of aggression. In this recreational area, rudimentary structures were erected to correct and channel aggressive desires into creative confrontations. The unfolding ego-work dialectic generates the continuous emergence of conflicting ideologies. The park is a reservoir of sustained tension, waiting to be released, a gigantic playground of flexible dimensions to accommodate the strip's only sport, aggression. Here, conflicts are reenacted, the stage battles dissolve the corrosive habit of good manners. On an individual level, the park is a sanatorium where patients can recover from remnants of the old world infections, hypocrisy and genocide. The diagnoses provide richer forms of intercourse. The most prominent edifices are the two towers. One is infinite, a continuous spiral. The other, consisting of 42 platforms, has a familiar architectural style. Magnetic fields between these two towers create a tension that mirrors the psychological motivations of their users. Entry to the park is free, and performances are continuous. Visitors arrive alone, in pairs, or in small groups, but these private antagonisms are also spectators. The shelves below serve as viewing galleries which overlook the larger platforms of the tower, provoking visitors to join groups involved in unknown physical transactions. As remnants of shyness are overcome, visitors add their private energies to this incredibly mutant form of social behavior. In an agitated sleep, they descend the tower, they ascend the tower, and as they pierce each floor, their view of the activity below improves. And around the architecture of great heights, they experience an exhilarating sensation of the unfolding spectacle. The entire surface of the park, the air above, and the cavities below becomes a full-scale battlefield. As the operations continue into the night, they take on the appearance of hallucinatory celebrations against the backdrop of an abandoned world. As they return from their nocturnal adventure, the visitors celebrate their collective victories in a gigantic arena that crosses the park diagonally. The allotments. To recover in privacy from the demands of intense collectivism, each voluntary prisoner has a small piece of land for private cultivation. The houses on these allotments are built from the most lush and expensive materials, marble, chromium, steel. They are small palaces for the people. On a shameless subliminal level, this simple architecture succeeds in its ambition to instill gratitude and contentment. Nothing new ever happens here, yet the air is heavy with exhilaration. The square of a captive globe. This square is devoted to the artificial conception and accelerated birth of theories, interpretations, mental constructions and proposals, and their infliction on the world. It is a capital of ego, where science, art, poetry, and certain forms of manias will be allowed to compete under ideal and identical conditions, to invent the answers to metaphysical questions, to destroy and restore the world of phenomenal reality. And this particular drawing later became very well known. It was a sketch that Rem himself produced, and that was then later painted by Zoe Zenghelis And then it was exhibited and it acquired it, it became quite well known. The change of this, so anyway, to go back to the text, these terms will be visualizations and symptoms of ideas, a spectacle of sublime communication. The changes of this ideological skyline will be rapid and continuous, a rich spectacle of moral fever, ethical joy, or intellectual masturbation. The globe gains weight, its temperature rises slowly, invisibly it grows. We all have our ear on the stethoscope of the ideologies. The question is, who will crack first? The skin of this impossible egg, or perhaps ourselves? And finally, the last drawing of this project is a drawing called the Avaro. To express their everlasting gratitude, the voluntary prisoners sing an ode to the architecture by which they are forever enclosed. And the epilogue read, although at first sight the metaphorical message of these proposals may seem to dominate practical considerations, this is not another utopian scale. The zone can be built today, if necessary in segments, perhaps with a modified location, perhaps with the segments dropped like stones apart from each other and only connected by the overlapping ripples caused by their impact on the urban pond, like true social condensers. It requires a fundamental belief in cities as incubators of social desires, but also in the synthetic materialization of dreaming. If people were allowed to become acquainted with architecture, they would reappropriate the physical and ideological decay of our urban societies, and they would rehabilitate the premises of the metropolitan ideal. Under the threat of doom, the concern for these ideals, reactivation, produces phantom proposals, in the knowledge that phantom reality is the only possible successor to the present reality shortage. So I think that, as Bob said, that we, at 6:45 we go for drink. I very quickly run through, we did a series of projects that, together with Ben that followed this this project with the cities, some including some projects that we each done individually. Together we did a competition for housing on Roosevelt Island, then I produced it on a project that ran east-west along along 42nd Avenue. And then I produced a proposal for a luxury hotel. This luxury hotel called Hotel Sphinx was supposed to be an alternative to these welfare hotels for which there were a lot of complaints that people were urinating in the staircases. And I said that, you know, if you give them a Hilton or a luxury hotel, they would not urinate. It's a question of respect and mutual response. So this was a kind of a project that was kind of filled with its own set of ideological references. On Times Square, facing Times Square, facing the Times Building, which is a billboard with its own, with its own ideological references, and the Sphinx Hotel had its own answers. The neck consisted of a series of activities devoted to physical activity, from from hairdressers, gymnasiums, etc. The top of which was a swimming pool at the very top, to which you could swim to the edge and enjoy the view, and with a planetarium, with a bar and a planetarium above it. And before we left New York to return to Europe, we did this drawing, which is a collection of individual projects that we each did, or together we did, for Manhattan. And in Europe, the first project we did was a competition for the deputies and public accommodation for the Dutch Houses of Parliament in The Hague, which is a kind of a very interesting assembly of buildings from various historical periods, because it's a pileup of buildings built at different times in history. And our intervention was adding the kind of 20th century element that to complete the composition. It consisted of the areas for the public, with which this is a drawing showing the areas for the public. This is another drawing. We collaborated in this drawing, in this project, with Zaha Hadid. After this project, Zaha told us, "I'm never going to work with you ever again." But anyway, it was a very eventful collaboration. But I think it ended up producing one of our best projects. So whereas this is a drawing of mine showing the public in Tunis, this is a drawing of Zaha, which already her personal way of representation is evident. At this point, she did her own entry for the Irish Prime Minister House, and we did ours separately. And this is our proposal, which Zaha called the two bananas. And now I'm going to really run fast to come to the end, because we, of course, this is a competition that I did for a project for housing in Berlin on a street called Lützowstrasse, where I won the joint first prize together with Gregotti. We had agreed with Gregotti how we would divide the part, the project, who would be which part. It was an agreement with which I liked very much. Rem made a deal with Kleikos, who was in charge of all the building projects, that he wanted us to build a building for him. I mean, I'm going to tell this kind of anecdote because it's interesting. He was obsessed with doing a project for next to the wall, because he, as a student, he had done an amazingly interesting study of the wall, which is kind of a project on Checkpoint Charlie. So he managed to convince, and he took part in the competition for the Checkpoint Charlie. He did not win the competition. It was won by Bohigas. Bohigas is being an incredibly nice gentleman. Under the pressure of Rem wanting to do the Checkpoint Charlie building, which was really only a part of the competition, he gave offer the site. He said, "Of course, by all means, do it." But Rem's idea of building by Checkpoint Charlie was that the building should never be higher than the wall itself, which was. So he did an unbelievably beautiful mat building for the whole site, consisting of two-story courtyard houses with the occasional room as a third story. And of course, Clive said, "No way, we have to build a seven-story high building to be, because the policy of those series of competitions in Berlin like under the kind of the under the aegis of IBA, the Internationale Bauausstellung, which was kind of the covered kind of, was to restore Berlin to its original scale and appearance as it had been before the war, and that was before it was bombed. And this was a kind of a very typical German sentimental amnesia, which they repeated later with the war. In that kind of it eliminated, it was leaving out kind of a very important historical period which they wanted to forget. Berlin, in the meantime, had a very interesting, a very unique cityscape, which was a kind of a cityscape of quite unique of buildings in kind of semi-empty sites with kind of with the exposure of what of the party walls between buildings, what these party walls being it's kind of a plain beautiful brick walls. They call them firewalls. And our approach and our policy was to try to preserve that kind of cityscape. But no way, they wanted it all kind of sealed again. But Rem became very, very stubborn and very consistent. No, he wouldn't do the building, he wouldn't do a seven-story building, no, it had to be. So then he turned to me and said, what do you do? And Clive said, ask me, will you do a seven-story building? And yes, I will. So the building that came in, and Rem was very happy, as long as he didn't have to do it. This is the building, I mean, as it was then, because since then it has been completely destroyed by different uses of the clients have given to it. The ground floor was a garage, which was to be used by the Allies, because it was by the checkpoint where the Allies were coming in and out of East Berlin. And so they used the garage to be debriefed for little conferences, and sometimes even there were some sleeping rooms where they could rest. This was a kind of a layout that showed the circulation of the cars and also the lighting plan of the roof above the garage. This was how the building at the time. In order to, as a concession to Rem, I pushed the building a little bit back from the building line, something that strangely Clive was accepted, and which also exposed a little bit of the firewall of the adjoining building. The roof was symbolized the fact that it was at this point that during the Berlin, what was it called, when in 1948 the Allies, they provided the bridge because Stalin had isolated Berlin, so they provided the bridge to West Berlin in order that it survived. So anyway, this was a postcard from the time. Okay. The rest of the project, this was a project in Greece where I had to do some villas, little bungalows on an island site, a kind of island in Antiparos. It was for me very difficult because I've never dealt with a kind of natural landscape. We were kind of immersed in this idea of the metropolis and metropolis. Suddenly it was a site, an empty site, which just very beautiful site in the Mediterranean with nothing on. Just the sea and the gentle slope. It was a very hard thing to do, and so I decided the only way to solve it is to treat the site as a painting and really to look at it as a composition. But what was very interesting is that it was very useful in that this was done a year before we were invited to take part in another competition, which was for the Park of La Villette in Paris, which was a very important, again, a very important site in which composition, again, became very important. So those kind of little, we call them confetti, became a very important element in the composition of the little points that the site in Paris required, which was basically the concept of a series of horizontal bands, which kind of continued an existing one, which was a canal that was going there, plus these little point kiosks. And that was a kind of an overall final composition. And these were the drawings of the trees and landscape. We did not win that competition. It was a very big blow because we believed we should win it. It was one project that we really felt very strongly we should win. As a consolation, we were given to do another little park in Paris, a park de Cévennes, Citroën Park, which actually the winner did quite a nice job. But again, this was our entry, and again we didn't win. And then after I left OMA to be on my own with my partner, Eleni Gigantes, we took part in another competition that we won in Berlin, on Monte Verde, which consisted of housing and the kind of a manipulation of the canal. That was just before the canal entered the east, but even though we won the competition, it was not built by us. We had this experience in Berlin three times, doing competition, winning, and the job being taken by others. So we concluded that Berlin was one of the most corrupt cities in Europe. More corrupt than Greece, because this is a project in Greece, because this is a project that we won, and we were about, it's a landscape project on an island. We were about to do it, but they were short of money in the end. It was kind of a very ambitious. So I'm running through a series of drawings for a number of landscape projects in Greece until we won another competition for the administration center, a very big competition, the administration center of the Flemish community in the city of Leuven in Flanders, Belgium. It was an office administration building of 33,000 square meters, so it was a really big job, and we were very happy to have won it. We had the full support of the design was entirely kind of local brick. Everything was done in brick, including the horizontal surfaces. We had the support of the in Belgium they have a very important position, which is a kind of city state architect who actually is also kind of like a minister in the government. He supported us a lot, but the local council did not want this job at all. And there was a local architect who really wanted the job, really was coveting the job badly. These were kind of isometrics showing the kind of circulation through the building and the perspective. It was next to the bus station and the railroad station. The council submitted the pressure of this local firm, and they did. They found some excuse for doing a repeat competition, and somehow we don't know how the drawings of our project managed to seep through to the Leuven architect, who produced a building based on our drawings. Very similar, but a completely different, almost identical, but a completely different forms and materials. And he won, which made us think that, you know, Belgium is the next corrupt city. So Germany and Belgium, the two corrupt countries in Europe. And this is the result of this, is the building, how they materialized. They changed proportions, they changed material. From brick they went to granite, and somehow this, our next disaster after La Villette, which is kind of in conclusion, after these two jobs and these two failures, I have become allergic to the realization of buildings. I'm no longer interested in having buildings built. I hate clients. I really literally hate them, and I get allergy. I mean, I had a client who actually was quite good in Greece, and I just left him, and I told him, you finish with someone else. And things were going quite well. I do competitions as long as they're kind of public projects, and I don't care if I don't win, I just enjoy doing the competitions. And otherwise I've reverted back to doing the kind of drawings that I've always liked doing in my youth. As a consolation to this loss, we were asked to do a garden for this little, between these two walls, for an old people's home, which some kind of was a bit of a consolation, that this was the project that we proposed. We then worked together with DOMA on a competition in Greece for a park to replace the old international airport. And as it's becoming 6:45, I'm going to very quickly run through this. The park was based on a kind of grid that the grid was denser towards the, as it went towards the center, the more urban parts of Greece, and the grid was getting wider towards the more suburban part. Actually, in all the projects that I work, I always have a grid. I don't always show it, but in this case, it was a part and parcel of the, again, composition. And I use the word composition because for me, in architecture, composition is something that I consider very important. This was the main runway of the old airport. And these are a few vignettes, a few sketches of views of how we visualized the park should be. As we did not know who the architect would be for the buildings, we left them, we knew where the buildings would be, but we left them black. And finally, the last project is again with the same team, same collaboration, a kind of to rework the shoreline of the city of Flore in Albania, and to turn it into kind of public venue, because it was kind of sort of cut off from the city. We provided about four horizontal zones going along the coast. One was a kind of pine forest, because that was also something already existing, and we just cemented it as a kind of a continuous green belt, and we added the continuous pedestrian boulevard, and then a series of piers going into the sea. The piers then became kind of extensions of the public domain. And so I complete with some illustrations of what was proposed to happen on the piers at different times. There would be different things happening. So the sequence of the importance of the elements was, of course, the primary element was the piers itself, then the boulevard, then the pine forest, and then the various facilities that linked to the center of the city. Then the small-scale facilities that were both inland and floating on the water. And that was the kind of overall composition for the whole project. And finally, a few views. With, of course, different activities depending on the time of day, so that late evening or early morning the fish, it would attract the fishermen. And at night it would attract the public, perhaps in the summer for cinema shows, you know, open air cinema. And that's the last image. Thank you very much. The physical appearance, the presence of buildings, the thing that kind of at first attracts me, and also the way in which the interiors are built, the way they are planned, and how rational the functions are organized, is something that doesn't really interest me so much as long as the buildings are beautiful. This kind of applied more for the Exodus project, where the text becomes very important. So it was a very, they did influence each other, but alternatively. In some cases, for sure, the image was what influenced the text. But in some cases, there were parts in which we wanted to illustrate text. So it happened. In this particular project, yes. In the other projects, I mean, I think text is really only matters in the sense that when one explains the project, one should give a clear, simple, clear explanation of the building, because I think architecture is a text on its own, you know? It's a dumb thing, it doesn't, it speaks for itself, for sure. So it's a question of really saying what it is and what you're doing. In a way, what is your concept and what are the intentions, although it's something that we always ask from students, but I mean, this is an educational thing, otherwise I think it's not that important. It's something personal.
One cannot but be struck by a projection of the imagine or the imagination onto the real. Can you speak of that particular space that you have found? Has it been consistent for you, and how did it develop?
So
the separation of the particular interface between the imagine and the real.
Yes, it's a good question, a difficult question. The importance of either of these two very much depends on or varies. If, for instance, one is designing something in order for it to be built, then the real becomes the most important. How you will be able to illustrate in the real what you have in your mind as the concept. But that is, as this is something that doesn't interest me anymore, then it's often is kind of reversed. That I'm kind of, in other words, I now work with fantasy more, with phantom reality rather than reality. But then that has become like a personal old man's preoccupation.
Yeah, you've been talking today about some almost reality aspects of exodus.
Yes.
You could imagine that
was written then, in 1972.
Okay.
So I just read the text as it was there. So it was written in the youth and in the kind of enthusiasm of believing that the world is open or that we could realize this thing.
You hadn't been thinking of Exodus at that time as you're
talking. Or? We were thinking of it as a venue to illustrate architecture, because you have to remember that at that time, it was just when Archigraph had just kind of had its big glory at the AA, and when after Archigraph, what was being done in the community of the AA, which is where we were, was either the leftovers of Archigraph or a smoking pot. In the seminar rooms where they would gather in the seminar room, cook rice, and get stoned. And so the architecture had gone by the door.
So Exodus was vehicle to come back.
Yes. to come back to monuments.
Right. So with that image of stone.
Thank you very much.